Our call to worship is taken from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's, and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas, and established it upon the waters. Lift up your heads, O you gates, and be lifted up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates, lift up, you everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Let us worship our God.
His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. The hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree and took the nails for me. Cause living, he loved me. Dying, he saved me. And buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. save me. Buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming on glorious day. Oh, glorious day.
Hi everyone.
Hi guys.
Hi everyone. I mean, hi Effie.
Hey.
Yeah, just to let you know that me and my family, we are safe and well. All glory be to God. my prayer is that every one of us will keep safe and well. We miss the church. We miss everyone. God has been so good to us, and there has not been any reason to complain. God has been so faithful, and I really appreciate God for that. And it's my prayer by the day that every one of us, by the grace of God, will keep safe and well. And let's just keep praying for other people in other nations, believers everywhere, so that the hand of God will keep them safe and sound. And as many that are sick, that God will bring healing to their body. Amen. Praise God. Just stay safe and well. God bless you. Thank you very much.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
This is Brother Emmanuel. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness and mercy. Thank you because you've been so good to us. Thank you because through thick and thin, you've been there for us. Lord, we say be glorified. Our Lord, we commit every one of your children all over the world into your hand. We pray that at this perilous time, at this turbulent time, you will keep your people in perfect peace. For the Bible said, thou will keep him in perfect peace whose heart is stayed on thee. Lord, keep your people in perfect peace. And Father, for everyone that is under the grip of this pestilence and affliction, we ask that your mercy will prevail. Deliver your children. Deliver your people. Let your mercy, O God, prevail over judgment. Thank you, Father, for we know you've answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Dear Father, we come to you humbly in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And our hearts are heavy for those who don't know you at this really fearful and dreadful time. They're not praying to you, Lord, but we are. We bring them to you. We stand in the gap for them, Lord, and we ask you, by your miraculous ways of doing things, that you will reveal yourself to them. In their need, Lord, may they cry to you and find in you their rock, their salvation, their hope of glory. We pray this in the name of our beautiful Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Dear Lord Jesus, I pray during this time of great uncertainty and fear that, Lord, through all this, you, my Lord, will be seen. Your presence will be felt, Lord Jesus, throughout this world, that, Lord, during the time of darkness, you, Lord Jesus, will be glorified. In your precious name I pray these things. Amen.
Father God, we just thank you today for your goodness, Lord, for your grace and for your mercy, Lord. We thank you for every good thing comes from you, Lord, of your own day we give you today. Lord, I thank you for every answered prayer, Lord, every act of kindness from you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, that you've said your ways are higher than our ways and your thoughts are higher than our thoughts, Lord. But we thank you, Lord, that you're in complete control of every situation in our lives, Lord. And Father, nothing takes you by surprise, Lord. You are well aware, Lord, of the situation that the whole world is facing right now. But Father God, you hold the whole world in your hands, Lord. You flung the stars into space, Lord, and you called each by name. So we thank you, Lord, today for your grace, Lord, for your tender, loving mercy, Lord. We thank you for Jesus, Lord, the lovely Jesus that died on the cross, that we might have life, Lord, and have it more abundantly, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you've said you make everything beautiful in your time, Lord, but you said, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be given unto you. And we just thank you today that you said in times of trouble you will hide us in your pavilion, Lord, in the secret place of your tabernacle you'll hide us, Lord. You'll lift us high upon a rock, Lord. You've told us everything we need for, Lord, for life and holiness, and we thank you today, Lord. We just thank you, Lord, that you just love us so much. You said we're the apple of your eye, Lord. You said that, Lord, you've said, Lord, that you just love us, Lord. You are your children, Lord. We're your flock, and you're your shepherd, Lord, and you lead us and guide us, Lord. We've got nothing to fear because you've said that perfect love casts out all fear. Oh, and I just thank you today, Lord, for your goodness. I thank you for your precious Holy Spirit, Lord. And you know everything's underpinned today by your grace, Lord. And we just tell you that we love you, Lord. And we just thank you that Jesus said, fear not, fear not. And you've said, I'll be with you till the end of time. Oh, God, we've got nothing to fear today in Jesus' lovely name, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, that you're ever with us, Lord. You're ever with us, Lord. You hold us, Lord, in the palm of your hand, Lord. You've got our name engraved in the palm of your hand, Lord. And we just tell you today that we love you, Lord. Oh, I just love you so much today, Lord. I thank you for your precious gift of salvation, Lord. Oh, praise your name, Lord. Amen.
Strength arises, we wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord.
You do not need you all, go weary. Hi boys and girls, I'm just going to read Teddy a story. Hope you'll listen to it too. Are you sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin. It was early in the morning when she dragged herself off her bed. As painful as usual, for 12 years she'd been like this. She thought to herself, today could be a different. It could be the beginning of a new life, for he was coming. And she could get to see him as well. She hurried out, not waiting to eat. There was no time for that. There was already crowds of people around. Then she saw him. He was everything that she had heard. Yes, she thought, today could be the day. She pushed her way through the crowd. It wasn't easy. Many people were trying to reach him. But as she drew near, horror came upon her face. No, she cried. He's been called away to heal someone's daughter. She became frantic. You can't do this to me, she thought, as she struggled towards him. Today is my day. Her body was aching. He's my only hope. Just to touch his cloak would be enough. She stretched out her hand there. There he was. As she touched, her pain stopped. But so had he. And now he was asking, who touched me? Should I tell him? Again he asked. In a stumbling voice she said, it was I. I touched you. I believe that you could heal me. And it has happened. Jesus looked at her, and she felt a warm, gentle love flow over her. She spoke softly, yet firmly. Your faith has made you whole. Go in peace. As she walked home, slowly, she thought to herself, today is my day. What do you think, Ted? How Jesus healed that lady? That was good, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Well, boys and girls, see you next time. Bye.
We just want to thank you for your financial commitments that you give each week to the church. We still have a lot of financial commitments, even though we're not attending. So please look at the website and give checks or cash through the bank. We're going to pray now and thank God for his blessings to us financially. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that you are a loving and a wonderful God. We thank you for the people that give regularly to our church, towards others coming to know Jesus as a personal saviour. We thank you, Father, that they want to give, and we ask that you will bless each penny. that is collected in our collection throughout each Sunday, and that you will bless it and use it for the furtherance of your kingdom. Thank you, Father, for your love towards us. In your Son's name, amen.
I'm going to be reading from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 1 to 12. This letter is from Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. I'm writing to God's chosen people who are living as foreigners in the lands of Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, the province of Asia, and Bithynia. God the Father chose you long ago, and the Spirit has made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed Jesus Christ and are cleansed by his blood. May you have more and more of God's special favour and wonderful peace. All honour to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for it is by his boundless mercy that God has given us the privilege of being born again. Now we live with a wonderful expectation because Jesus Christ rose again from the dead. For God has reserved a priceless inheritance for his children. It is kept in heaven for you, pure and undefiled, beyond the reach and change of decay. And God, in his mighty power, will protect you until you receive this salvation because you are trusting him. It will be revealed on the last day for all to see, so be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, and even though it is necessary for you to endure many trials for a while, these trials are only to test your faith, to show that it is strong and pure. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, and your faith is far more precious to God than mere gold. So if your faith remains strong after being tried by fiery trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honour on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. You love him even though you have never seen him. Though you do not see him, you trust him. And even now you are happy with a glorious, inexpressible joy. Your reward for trusting him will be the salvation of your souls. This salvation was something the prophets wanted to know more about. They prophesied about this gracious salvation prepared for you, even though they had many questions as to what it all could mean. They wondered what the Spirit of Christ within them was talking about when he told them in advance about Christ's suffering and his great glory afterward. They wondered when to whom all this would happen. They were told that these things would not happen during their lifetime, but many years later, during yours. And now this good news has been announced by those who preach to you in the power of the Holy Spirit sent from heaven. It is so wonderful that even the angels are eagerly watching these things happen.
Well, let's come to the Word of God as we come to that passage that was read for us in the first epistle of Peter. And I wonder, has it escaped anybody's knowledge, I doubt it, that we are living in a global pandemic that is devastating the lives of the most vulnerable in our society, and the consequences of which we see outlived on our screens and even now within our own immediate homes. This COVID-19 virus has already proved to the majority of the informed world that it is unprecedented in its reach and impact upon humanity. As we have witnessed already, the reaction to it has understandably been unprecedented. Fighting fire with fire. Certainly, have we not seen this in the recent measures that our governments have taken and many others? And we know that there may well be more unprecedented measures to come in the near future. There hasn't been one government, as far as we are reasonably informed, that hasn't refused to take drastic measures. Every member of society has been called up. There are simple measures that we have been called to do. We are to regularly wash our hands for at least 20 seconds, and frequently and regularly. We're to stay at home and only to leave for essential duties such as exercise and shopping for necessities. And when we do venture out, we are to maintain what is now commonly called social distancing at least 2 meters or 6 foot in old currency. Our most vulnerable are in effect to be quarantined for at least the next 12 weeks or until advised otherwise. We are to self-isolate if we have any of the most common symptoms, such as a new persistent cough or a fever. And as you can see, as we know, literally everyone, old or young, rich or poor, worker or unemployed, has an essential part to play, a part that will not only affect ourselves, but also have an effect on others. Well, what has all this got to do with 1 Peter and chapter 1, let alone with us during this calamity? Well, in some respects, there are some parallels which I hope will help us all, irrespective as to those who we are or what role we have in church or society. You see, the church in the time of Peter was entering into an experience of unprecedented change in their lives as Christians. Many of them were having to endure hardship on account of their simply being Christians. This varied in degree and varied from city to city. Not every unbeliever opposed the church. In fact, many applauded the measures that Christians went in relieving the poor and the sick. A significant proportion of relief work still has its origins in the early church movement. Christianity benefits the world. A movement that continues to this day, and it's a degree of foolishness upon a society that threatens to quash a church's impact on its society. Yet Peter is writing his letter to a significant number of people that were forced by the states and the public to leave their homes out of fear for their lives. Pilgrims to the pilgrims or sojourners of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia and Bithynia, a huge significant area. And now they are regarded as pilgrims. It's an insulting term, really. Vagabonds. But look what Peter, he's writing to them, to the pilgrims. Even these he's writing to, these people that have been displaced on the run. And note that Peter doesn't rebuke them for running away. There's no call for foolish heroism. The responsibility on their leaving their homes was others. These Christians, they did all in their power to preserve what we might call life and limb, even at the cost of forfeiting their own jobs, their homes, their family, and even friends. And no doubt many forfeited their studies and lost out on promotions and incredible career prospects. Many had to leave their neighbours and even friends who were turned against them on account of their faith in action. Many Christians had to leave their newly established apostolic church plants, the places that had probably witnessed fantastic preaching and supernatural miracles, places that had seen many people converted from their paganism and Judaism to Christ. Now it was going, and soon it would be gone for good. The virus, if you like, of anti-Christian sentiment that intruded all sectors of Christian living. You couldn't see it, you couldn't smell it, but as a Christian, certainly in those days, you felt it. And now it had gotten worse, and many were forced to leave as a result. No doubt there were some who were tempted to pack in this Christianity and to go back to the good old days. At least life was normal then. And so Peter is coming, and he's seeking to address them as his pastor, these people that he calls the elect. They've been elected by God, and now they will be ejected by man. And that trend tends to be a pattern in the history of the Christian church at various stages. And Peter knows from personal experience the pressures that Christians face and what they are facing. In fact, he's able to draw, do we not remember, upon his own sad, lamentable experience of under the pressure, knowing the heat, he denied the Lord Jesus Christ. We also know from the epistles from the book of Acts that he knew imprisonment and torture himself. And now he's coming alongside these Christians. He's coming alongside them in the fiery trials that they are facing. Just like the one who came alongside Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. Do you remember them in the book of Daniel, when those three men were in the furnace, but the king saw another one standing with them? Well, Peter, in one sense, he's coming alongside his fellow sufferers. And that's good for us to be reminded of, that we are to come alongside those who are suffering, to bring the word of God, to bring encouragement, exhortation. Peter, at the beginning of his epistle, he's seeking to remind them that though they are pilgrims, though they've been cast out, he reminds them that their identity is not governed by what men say they are. Now, no doubt, they've been stripped of their citizenship and the many privileges that included. No more employment opportunities, no more tax benefits, no special deals, no voting rights, no rights to welfare protection and judicial support. These Christians were literally regarded as tramps, vagabonds, nobodies. And yet Peter comes by the power of the Holy Spirit to remind these Christians who they are and how. And before they can live out under the fiery trials, he reminds them who they are, their identity. Who does he remind them as? He reminds them, first of all, that they are elect. That no matter what man might say, even though they've been deselected by humanity, these are the elect of God. They've been chosen, as Paul writes in Ephesians 1, before the foundations of the world, chosen in Christ. Chosen, even when these people themselves were once persecutors of Christians. Do you remember the Apostle Paul, a chief antagonist of the church? He has an encounter with the resurrected Christ. Paul, Paul, why do you persecute me? And we have a glorious example in the life of Paul, as well as of Peter, transformed. Because they are the elect of God. And that's good for us to remind ourselves that irrespective of what is happening in our time, despite the headlines, the current headlines, and even the potential headlines, one thing that we can take great comfort in is that as the people of God, we are the elect. We've been chosen by God, according to the foreknowledge of God. We are chosen in the wisdom of God. Everything that happens to us is governed by God, a holy God, a loving God, as we'll soon see. And so take comfort if you're a believer watching this today. No matter what people might say you are the elect of God. He has chosen you before the foundation of the world, not because there was anything in you, but according to his infinite mercy and grace and wisdom, God has chosen us, and it is glorious. Even when we might not be chosen by this world, we can say that we are chosen by God. But then Peter says, not only are we elect, but that we are the children of God, elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father. He says later on in verse 17, and if you call upon the Father. So how are we made children of God? Because Paul in Ephesians 2 and verse 3, if you want to read that later on, we are called children of wrath. So by nature, we are not the children of God. But we've been made children. According to his abundant mercy, he has begotten us to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. He has begotten us. We've been born again. We've been brought into a living relationship. We were once children of wrath. We were dead in our sins, as Paul says in Ephesians 2. But now he has quickened us by his Spirit, and we have been given authority. We have been given power. As John writes in his gospel, we've been given power to be called the children of God. Isn't that glorious? That for these Christians who've been separated from their families, sons who've been thrown out of the home on account of being Christians, but they are part of the family of God. And God is their Father. According to his abundant mercy, he has begotten us to a living hope. And we are only given new birth on account of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. He has begotten us again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. His blood alone washes our sin and our guilt. It washes the deadly virus of sin away from us. It is removed from us. Now, scientists suggest a concentration of at least 60% of alcohol is required for effective sanitizers. Now, we all know that soap is the best. Well, can I suggest to you that the blood of Jesus Christ is 100% effective for removing and for forgiving our sin. His death on Calvary not only removes, but destroys, kills all known sin dead, as the bottle of bleach says, does it not? Because he died, we now live. We have died, Paul says, we have died with Christ. We are hidden in him. And so, Christian, where is your sin? It is nailed to his cross, and we bear its guilt no more. We have died with Christ, and because we have died with Christ, we now live in Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. We have, in effect, the Jesus vaccine. The Holy Spirit lives in us. He brings both the death and life of Christ into our souls. He applies the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. He brings the resurrection, all that the resurrection meant to God, the satisfaction of punishment for sin. That is now ours, and we are made alive. Oh, look at it. He has begotten us again to a living hope. Christian, we live in a world where there is much death and dying, and there is understandably much to be fearful of. But know this, we are living stones. We have a living hope. We no longer live in fear of what man can do. We no longer live in the fear of death. The final enemy, death, has been conquered in the Lord Jesus Christ. When he died on that Good Friday, as we'll soon be remembering, he put to death, death, your death, my death. He has defeated death once and for all. It is finished. And so the Christian is able to rejoice greatly in the Lord. Our final enemy has been defeated in his cross and resurrection. We've been raised spiritually, and we are guaranteed that one day, just like Jesus, our bodies, these very bodies, will rise from their graves. No matter how they are lowered into the grave, whether it's through disease, whether it's through, as an experience of the early church and countless martyrs throughout the ages, and even to the present day. One thing is guaranteed, one certainty, one glorious truth, is that the dead in Christ will rise because he lives. And that comes to my closing point here. Peter reminds us that we are the elect, reminds us that we are the children of God, but reminds us that we are inheritors. Look at verse 4. To an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that does not fade away, reserved in heaven for you. These Christians had been forced into exile, excluded, ejected, rejected. They lost everything, and no longer were they allowed access to their homes, to their places of work, to their places of leisure, not even allowed access to where they would meet as Christians for worship. Excluded, scattered. It reminds me that in this current day that we find ourselves, these strange, unusual days where COVID-19 has captured the headlines, understandably, and where we ourselves have responded by keeping ourselves in isolation. And for those who have the virus in particular, they are excluded even more from the mainstream of life. Even our own Prime Minister has been reported of having the virus. And so, in passing, pray for those in authority over us. Pray for our Prime Minister. It's essential for the well-being of our nation that our leaders are in a place of wellness. But just in closing, because of this virus of sin in our hearts, we have separated ourselves from God. Our sins have separated us from God. You see, heaven is no place for sin. Heaven is no place for sinners. But thanks be to God, we have been vaccinated, in effect, by the power of God for glory. Some vaccines, as you know, have to be re-injected. You need boosters. They lose their potency for whatever biochemical reason. But not with God. Peter writes, we've been kept by the power of God through faith for salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. Praise God. We are kept. We are preserved by the power of the Holy Spirit. And our inheritance does not fade away. These people had to leave homes. Many wouldn't see their homes and places for years, perhaps never. And I can imagine some people who have been away from home for years and they go back for the first time. And no doubt they are filled with joy, but I've got no doubts either that they're filled with sorrow, that things have changed and certain familiar buildings are no longer there. Certain landmarks have been changed and transformed by possibly war or carnage. But not with the glory of heaven. It doesn't fade. The promises of God do not fade. Glory does not fade. It's always reserved for us. Because he lives, as the song goes, I can face tomorrow. Isn't that glorious? If you haven't seen it already, just Google that and you'll see in Brazil, I think it was, in one of the cities, that in the evening, the whole city erupted in song, in singing this, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. And we as believers agree with that. We have a bright hope, a glorious hope, a living hope, a secure hope. We can sing, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. But I want to give you an amendment. Because he lives, I can face today. I can face this afternoon. I can face whatever tonight might bring. I can face today because I belong to God. He has chosen me before all the events in my life. There is nothing without his knowledge, without his sovereign purpose. Before I rejected him, before, like Peter, I denied him, he chose me. I'm secure in his holy and perfect knowledge and purposes. I can face today because he has washed all my sin away. I can face today that because he lives in me by the power of his Spirit, I will take my reserved place in glory. I can face today because I am a child of his destiny. He is my Father. I can face today because I live in the secure hope that soon I'll be home with him. And all God's people said, Amen.
The highest king would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Who is free. Runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Who the sun sets free, always free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. A place for me. I'm a child.
inside.